I'm Deborah Lee Baldwin. In my midsummer succulent garden, heat stress and sun-scorched leaves all out there to help you learn from.
We've had temperatures in the high 80s and 90s in inland Southern California. Let's have a look at the succulents and how I prepare them for harsh temperatures. For example, this euphorbia is on my deck where it is in shade for most of the day. It only gets about an hour of sun first thing in the morning. And other plants I make sure are not sun-scorched include my string of pearls, which is very sun-sensitive. It can't have any direct sun. Also, it needs more water this time of year. This little aloe is thriving. It gets plenty of water, but it has a resident spider now, and there's no persuading the spider to go elsewhere. Other plants that I simply cannot put where direct sun will hit them when there's high heat include Phocarias and Haworthias. I learned the hard way this euphorbia was sun sensitive because I set it where the sun scorched it one year. I guess it's pretty much outgrown it by now. It gets absolutely no direct sun. Also out of the sun is this fairy washboard Haworthia and Sansevierias and Echeverias as well. I'm very aware of where the sun hits things on this deck, and the sun just blasts through here in the morning. I can have only cactus where it'll get sun most of the day. Certain plants, like this Gasteria, will sunscorch really easily. Euphorbias over here, one of them really got sunscorched. A lot of this you can tell is trial and error. You know, like this really pretty little aloe. Giving it plenty of sun to the point where it's stressed brings out the color in it. And other times it's just too much for the plant. Sometimes if the sun hits the stem will become incapable of carrying nutrients to the plant. Here's an example of a speckled aloe shaded by the Crassula. Where the sun doesn't hit the skin of the aloe, it's green. Where the leaves of the aloe get a lot of sun, are more colorful, and then to the point that they're getting too much sun, they're actually dried out on the tips. You know, I've heard it said that there's an aloe in bloom in every month of the year, and sure enough, one of my very favorite aloes is in bloom. This is one of the few succulents that I ever bought for its flowers, but I couldn't get over these umbels, these umbrella-shaped flowers. Look at these two new pads that have appeared since I carved this prickly pear in the spring. I decided to experiment. As far as its health is concerned, I certainly didn't compromise that. This is typical of a heat-stressed aloe. And the same plant is over here growing as an understory plant beneath this young oak. So here we have healthy and happy aloe that just a few feet away is closing its rosette to protect itself from further damage from heat and sun. I really love my giant agaves. I think they make the garden. They stand out and they're sculptural elements. But depending on where they're located, they have different responses to different weather extremes. Yeah, this is Agave Americana marginata. And it's doing fine. It's benefiting from the dappled shade. And then closer to us is another variegate of Agave Americana. They're not quite twins, but they're very similar. But this poor thing is getting all kinds of sunburn from where its leaves have curled back. It's one of those varieties that doesn't have perfectly upright leaves. It has leaves that kind of bend and twist and curl. Here we have Agave Francescini, also related to Americana. Flexible leaves bend downward from their own weight, making them all that more vulnerable. And then we have what is looking like a horrible mess. This Agave Americana, once the pride of my garden, the star even of some of my videos, decided to bloom beginning in April. A flower spike about 40 feet tall. Now the most amazing bird feeder in my garden because it attracts all kinds of nectar-eating birds as well as bees. It's going to be a challenge to remove when the time comes. Ornamental grasses make great companion plants for succulents. Summer, they're in bloom. Those tassels are the blooms of that miscanthus. This is the time of the year that echeverias come into bloom with their amazing heart-shaped flower spikes. This part of the garden I've shown you before, it's the succulent sitting area. Thanks to the moderating influence of this coast live oak
This area really doesn't look any different from summer to midwinter. Bright shade, the perfect microclimate. Aeoniums, variegates, don't get sun scorched, things that I wouldn't dare put out in full sun. Watch my video on trees for succulent gardens because trees make such a difference. And if you go out in the open, things really suffer from heat and sun exposure. And they're probably more in need of water. This part of the garden doesn't benefit much from the dappled shade of tree. It's much more exposed and therefore much more vulnerable. The dry birdbath is a canary in the mine shaft. It lets me know when the ground is dry as well. This stunning echeveria is Echeveria sahara. The largest over there on the left is benefiting from the shade of the tree, and as you get farther away from the tree, the smaller the echeveria is, even though they were all planted at the same time. These aeoniums benefit from bright shade. And then over here, getting a little farther away from the tree, are the same type of aeonium planted at the same time. They're a little lighter in color. Then if you get over here where there's full sun for most of the day, you can really see some sunburn. And that's what all that brown is. The leaves that are closest to the sun have scorched. There isn't a whole lot you can do, really. I mean, the plant is protecting itself. Its health is not seriously compromised. And these plants will come out of it. Now remember, when a succulent is heat stressed, it closes its rosette. And that exposes its lowest leaves to the bright, hot, scorching sun. Those are the very leaves that are destined to fall off anyway. Succulent rosettes grow from the center of the rosette, and the lowest leaves wither and fall off. So by closing the rosette, the plant is only sacrificing leaves that it was going to lose anyway. And you want to just leave those the way they are. The rains will come and the weather will cool, and pretty soon the plants will look really good again. One of my favorite succulents, Aloe brevifolia. And it's blue normally, and it stresses to shades of yellow and pink, which can be really pretty unless it gets too much, and then it just looks sad. There's not a lot of color in my summer garden. It's just too hot for most flowers. So these Nile lilies are a welcome relief. It's a refreshing blue. And they're great companions for succulents. They don't need much water. Also in bloom now is Hesperaloe parviflora. The common name is Texas red yucca, but it's not a yucca. So you hear that humming sound in the background? That's a sound of summer in Southern California. A heat pump, making it possible for our homes to be air conditioned. Aloe nobilis seems to be coming through the heat wave just fine. Or maybe it's just because it's more protected. In spring, this particular vantage point was really beautiful because of the overlapping mounds of brilliant ice plant in bloom. The Lampranthus ice plant is now looking kind of dingy because all those flowers have faded and all the little flower buds are just sort of lingering. They serve to shade the interior of the plant from the hot sun. Not surprisingly, midsummer is the worst possible time to take cuttings from plants and expect them to get off to a good start, because a truncated succulent has no way of taking up any moisture to keep it hydrated. So set your cuttings aside and wait for cooler weather. I have these window screens that I anchored to the top of a retaining wall with rocks. The screens extend out over the mangaves to give them a better microclimate. But even with that assistance, some of them are showing some sunburn, possibly desiccation. I'm experimenting with these plants, growing them for the first time, so I have a lot to learn. And observing them in all seasons and all different weather conditions is part of getting to know the plant. Look at the color on this Agave Colorata as it's dying. Here is its bloom stalk. Interesting, huh? Different. My Othonica pensis has colored up really beautifully from stress. Stress bringing out the colors of the plant. It'll go from a boring green to a lavender pink. The lower leaves of the succulent Othona fall off, revealing a stem, and then that gets too much sun, and its ability to transmit water to the leaves is compromised, which stresses them. And I'm not sure I like it, because It means my fauna is not very healthy. Yeah, I guess I like it. I'm Deborah Lee Baldwin in my garden.